What's happening out there, model makers? It's a fine fall morning here, and I have just completed one of my projects, and it's time to tell you all about it. If you have kept up with some of my videos, you know that I was recently invited to participate in a small buddy build with the Honorable Andy Firth and Gary Bottoms. And our challenge was to build the airfix 148th Spitfire in whatever way we saw fit. And in my first video about that, I did a kind of a combination unboxing construction review. I built it all the way up to the cockpit, and and then went over some of the issues that I found with it, and did my best to kind of give you guys a good overview of what the kit was like. And what I'm going to do today in part two of this mini series is show you the finished result and go over everything that I did and what I learned, not only about the aircraft itself, but the kit and some education that I got in the whole process. So first, before I get into all that and show you what I was able to come up with, let me tell you what I decided to pick as my specific subject. I wanted to do something interesting. I wanted to find an interesting paint scheme, and I originally wanted to do a photo recon Spitfire in the colors of Spitfire 944, which is a fascinating story. If you've never heard about that, I recommend Googling it. It's very cool. But it turns out that Spitfire 944 is, I believe, a Mark 12, and this kit is a Mark 1A. And so that limited my options on photo recon Spitfires. And I originally thought, well, I'm not going to be able to do one. And then as I got further into it, I realized that it's really a pretty interesting subject. And I never thought I would see myself building a pink Spitfire, but that's exactly what happened. And there's plenty of guys who know way more about these things than I do, but the basic summary of the pink Spitfires is this. When they did the early photo reconnaissance birds, they basically were just converting regular Spitfires, by mounting various cameras and painting them in more photo recon stealth-friendly colors. And about 20 of those aircraft, which were converted Mark 1s, were painted in what they called camo tint pink, which we have no good accurate historical photographs that I can find online of, but by description from a guy who says he has seen some of some color photos from a collection in the RAF museum, it's supposed to be very pale pink, almost white. That's his description. And it was painted that color. They were painted that color so that they would be difficult to see at dawn and at dusk, because the intent was that they were going to fly low altitude missions underneath cloud cover to photograph potential landing sites for the D-Day invasion. And the Mark 1s actually were equipped with the 8 303 machine guns that they originally came with, because they felt like these guys were possibly going to have to defend themselves from ground fire, and maybe even perform some tactical ground attack duties as well. So I thought that was really interesting. Here's a photo reconnaissance bird that is still armed with its weaponry and involved in some what I'm sure were pretty crazy missions, pretty dangerous probably. They called them dicing missions, as in dicing with death, if that tells you anything. But one thing in particular that I picked up through my research that I thought was kind of interesting for some of you guys who are you know, who like to go deep on technical knowledge, is that the photo reconnaissance birds had their own series of mark numbers that was separate from the regular Spitfires. So when they converted them from Mark 1s, they started out initially with what they called PRA, Photo Reconnaissance Model A, or Mark A, whatever you want to call it. And they went all the way up through PRG. And then they started converting them over to their own set of mark numbers. And it's pretty hard to say definitively, you know, but this one would probably be what would be called a Mark 4. Which is, you know, confusing because there is no Mark IV in the regular Spitfire lineup. As far as I understand it, you go from Mark II all the way up to Mark V. So anyway, the Mark IV was basically a Mark V that still had 8 machine guns, if that makes any sense. So anyway, it all worked out with the parts that were in the kit, and even with the decals, as you will see and as I will explain. But before I wear you out with any more detail on all of the what for and why for, let me show you what I did. Okay, so there you go, a few pictures. Let me now explain a few of the things that you might have seen in the pictures. One thing is the decals. I got really lucky on those. If you look around for reference photos online of PR Spitz, one of the ones that you'll see pretty quickly is has call numbers LY on it. And there's quite a bit of information about that aircraft online, but I didn't want to go, you know, trying to source an aftermarket set of decals, specifically with those letters, and I didn't feel like messing with printing my own. And part of what made that decision easier was the fact that the Airfix kit decals included the letters LV. And I thought, hey, you know what? If there was an LY, chances are there was an LV. You know, hey, it makes sense to me. It works. So I got lucky on that deal. Speaking in particular also about the decals, I have to say that these are also, I think I mentioned this in the initial video, these are cartograph decals. And my first encounter with those things was not that impressive. I mean, I didn't think that they were that much better than any other decals, but I have changed my tune after using these from the Airfix kit. I have heard that different manufacturers specify their decals differently, and that may be true. If so, kudos to Airfix for, you know, doing a good job of specifying the way that theirs are made, because these decals were fantastic. I put them straight on the paint and had absolutely no issues with silvering. There was, you know, you could barely see the carrier film, you know, even in between the letters, you know, like right here on the LV and some of the other places. So really, really outstanding decals. Okay, one other place that you may have or one other thing that you may have been curious about from the photos is the propeller. And you can see that it's got some kind of crazy hieroglyphics written all over it, and that it looks suspiciously less beat up than the rest of the aircraft does. This was kind of a spur-of-the-moment decision that I made when I was gathering photographs. I found one that is actually from an American photo recon group that was flying Spitfires, and it shows a couple of guys standing in front of an aircraft that has what looks to be a brand new prop on it, and it's got these numbers written all over it. And I initially thought that it was a date or something like that, but closer inspection revealed that it was not. And so what I decided was that maybe it was some kind of maintenance code that, you know, the guys who built and balanced the propeller may have written on there, or, you know, that the ground crew may have written on there for some specific reason. Regardless, I thought it was really cool. And so I ended up putting those numbers on there using a white watercolor pencil, which was a trick that I learned from Diego Quijano's Aircraft Encyclopedia. And I like the way it turned out. If there's, you know, some of you guys out there who actually know what these numbers mean, I would love to hear about it. So, you know, feel free to hit me up and tell me what you know. Speaking of call letters and hieroglyphics and, you know, hidden code and all of that, what you may also have noticed is that there appears to be, if you get a closer look here, you may have seen it in the photographs, that there appear to be some roundels here that have been painted over. And that if you look here on the side of the fuselage, that you can see, maybe not, that there are some call letters that have been painted over. I did kind of a crazy thing with this because my intention was that I wanted to show an aircraft, I wanted to try to tell a story with the paint of an aircraft that had been converted from a regular Mark I Spitfire and had been painted over, and that the paint, you know, wasn't as bad as like Eastern European German winter camo paint, but that it wasn't also, you know, normal factory quality. And that it also had been worn out, you know, through a lot of fading and weathering. And, you know, part of that also was because with pink, I mean, how do you paint pink? I knew that solid pink was going to look terrible, and I wanted to have a lot of tonal variation and, you know, things in there to make it interesting. But I thought, you know, what if I could have the original camo scheme and the original call letters sort of showing through that? And so my pre-shading, believe it or not, was I masked and painted the original camo scheme on this thing. I didn't do it, you know, perfectly, but I did try to get it to where it looked, you know, as plausible as I would have, you know, as I felt like it needed to be. And I also then put on some of the original decals. And I was lucky because in my research, I found out that the roundels for these PR spits were smaller and were in a different spot. And that kind of sold me on being able to do this, because if they had been directly over the old ones, it wouldn't have been as obvious that there were some, you know, some old ones underneath there, and it wouldn't have been as effective. I also got lucky in the fact that these aircraft didn't have any markings on the underside at all. So the whole thing just kind of worked out. I was struggling a little bit initially with coming up with a scheme and a story and how I really wanted to do this thing. And as I continue, you know, did my research and looking at photographs and reading, there was just a point where it all kind of clicked, and I felt like, okay, I think I could pull this off. So I will leave that up to you guys as to whether or not you feel like I did it effectively. One thing that I did do a lot of on this one, that's kind of my first time to really push it hard, was a lot of work on tonal variation with oil paints. I sprayed the base coat of pink in a very light and very random fashion, and it was the original pink was a color that I mixed up using some Model Master acrylics, and I thinned it at about 70% thinner, so it was already pretty translucent. But I really tried to vary my spray pattern and just go in no particular order, and you know, get as much variation as I could from that. But that wasn't enough, and so I went after it with a lot of different oil washes, filters, you know, oil dots, whatever you want to call them. I did a whole mishmash of things to try and achieve a lot of tonal variation. And I actually feel pretty good about the way it turned out. I'm, you know, looking for some feedback from some of you guys who are way more experienced at this than I am as to how well I pulled that off. But I have to say that I think one of the main takeaways I have from this project is that oils are magic. There's just so much that you can do with them, and they give you so much control. And I feel like they give you a much more natural, splotchy look when you apply them with sponges and brushes and things than you get when you try and airbrush a splotchy look. Because unless you're just very, very good at that, it's going to look like it's airbrushed. And that's not necessarily going to be a bad thing, but to me, it's a lot harder to get a truly realistic appearance by doing it that way. Okay, so that's, I think, about all I want to say about, you know, the result that I've got here, because this is already going to be a long video, and I need to spend some time talking about the kit and the build itself to sort of round this thing out. So let's move on to some nitty-gritty details about the construction. Okay, what I'm going to do is once again revert to the instruction sheet to go through this laundry list of things that I think are worth knowing about if you are planning to build or buy this kit. It's just easier that way to show you in the actual illustrations than to try and explain it, you know, over a photograph of or a shot of the model itself. The first thing that I'm going to address is the clear parts, because this became one of the major points of profanity in this project. If you watch the first video, you know that I was intending to build this closed coffin. There was a point where you had to make a decision about whether or not to trim a particular portion of the fuselage sidewall if you were going to do that. And I did do that. But I learned an important lesson. When I had initially looked at the clear parts, I had decided that they were clear enough based on just having them sitting on a printed page, kind of like I do here, and that you would be able to see the interior detail well enough. And I also specifically did the interior in a slightly more high contrast way than I might normally have done because of that strategy. I learned an important lesson, and that is something I'm going to demonstrate to you here, but I'm going to zoom way in first. Let me try and get this lined up. Okay, when you look here, this is one of the other airfix parts that I didn't use. And when you look here, you can see the print underneath there fairly clearly. It's not too bad. But when I pull the part about a quarter of an inch away, now things don't look nearly as good. You don't even have to pull it very far to be able to tell that. Obviously, the further away you get, the worse the effect becomes. But what I quickly discovered when I went to test fit the single piece canopy on the fuselage assembly was that not only could you not see any of the work that I put into the cockpit, but you couldn't even tell that I had a set of $10 Edward seat belts in there, and I lost my mind. And I decided that, there was no way I was gonna sacrifice all of that, you know, for a closed canopy. So even though I had already made that modification, I felt that I could get away with it with the closed canopy, and that's what I in fact ended up doing. And it's not too bad. Somebody who really knew what they were looking at could tell that it wasn't quite right, but it is what it is. Okay, now since I'm talking about clear plastic parts, and I'm gonna wear you guys out a little bit on this Airfix, you can see, let me position this so that it's directly over some, get in even closer here. So I've got this part positioned directly over these straight lines so that I can illustrate something here. You can see how the lines go wavy and when viewed through the lens of the canopy. And you might not think, oh, that's not horrible. But let me put this one. This is also a Spitfire bubble top. And look at the difference. Okay, this part came out of the Tamiya 148 Spitfire kit. And there is a distinct difference. When you look at these two pieces through an optivisor at high magnification, not only is the distortion greater on the Airfix part, but the Airfix part has a distinct texture on the inside of it. And that has a dramatic effect on the clarity that's just not there with this part from the Tamiya kit. So I'm really not saying this to rag on you guys, Airfix. I'm saying this because I like what you guys are doing, and this is a genuine effort to help you with quality control. I know that you know that this is a challenging thing with clear parts, but obviously it's doable, and I just wanted to put some direct sort of evidence there that lets you see kind of what the issues are. All right? Okay, enough about that. Let's stop beating that particular horse even further into the ground and move on to some other things, because there is plenty to talk about. Okay, let me get my paintbrush pointer here. As you guys may remember, when I left off with the last video, I had assembled the fuselage and I had assembled the cockpit and the wings. And there were a couple of things that I mentioned there that I need to sort of close the loop on. So if I can get open to the correct page here with my stupid clumsy fingers. Okay, so I showed you guys how badly I had screwed up the this thing right here with this little spar, and in getting it crooked, and I corrected that by basically just taking a very small notch out of this side of this former, pushing it down and gluing it back together. That took care of the straightness issue, but it did not glue down into this thing flush in any way, shape, or form like it appears in the picture here. And I had to make some adjustments to it. And once it was glued in place, basically sand down the top of it in order for it to be correct so that the canopy would in fact go down correctly the way that it was supposed to. Not a big deal. Certainly not as big a deal as this next issue was. Okay, when I went to glue the fuselage together, I found that the fuselage joint was 95% really good. The 5% that was not so good, however, was a real problem, because it was right here in about this quarter inch behind the cockpit opening where the gap was terrible. And as I investigated and worked with it, I discovered that it was basically because there was too much material on this former. And it wasn't because of the adjustment that I had to make to straighten this thing out. It was just too big. And I ended up having to sand the profile of that all the way around, as well as remove some material from the inside of the fuselage shell right there and still then had to rig up a crazy looking tourniquet type clamp to put pressure directly on that part of the joint in order to get it to close up. And I was able to do that, but it was quite a wrestling match. Stupid thing that I did, I attempted to put this oxygen bottle into the fuselage before I put this whole assembly in there. Don't do that. It doesn't work. Not even close. In fact, what I would recommend is that you put all of this subassembly minus this former, all of this subassembly minus the former into the right-hand side of the fuselage, then put the oxygen bottle in there, then put the former in place, because getting that oxygen bottle into that spot is really fiddly. There's just no good way to reach in there. Okay, now here is where we get to what was probably the single most offensive issue that I found and that the other guys found. This was not just me and my kit. And that was fitting this portion of the nose in place. It very clearly would not go on correctly. And a lot of fiddling and looking and studying, you know, made it pretty clear that it was interfering with the edge of the instrument panel and this bulkhead right here. So I had to do a lot of material removal on those parts around the edge there, you know, with them already installed, which was a real pain in the ass. But that even wasn't enough. And I ended up having to get after the inside of this piece with a grinding burr and my Proxon and take some material out of the inside of it. And even once I knew that it was that there was no interference, it still did not fit correctly on the bottom edge here on the left side, and I ended up having to fill and rescribe that panel line right there when it was all said and done. So that was definitely no fun, and that was just a clear issue of I don't know. It's hard for me to imagine that the parts ever fit because they were so far off. And so I have to call Airfix's attention to that, because that may be something that needs to be addressed with a tool engineering change order. I know that sucks, but that's, you know, these that's something that happens. Okay, let's move on to the next thing. When I assembled the fuselage to the wing, I discovered two things. First of all, this little light here that projects through there's a hole there. I don't know if it's supposed to match up with the hole that's on the bottom of the cockpit tub or what. But the bottom line is, there was just no way that I could get the fuselage to seat completely down into this area without just chopping the top of that piece off. So I don't know what the deal there is. That's, again, another thing that to me would bear some investigation and a possible change. Okay, with regard to the fuselage and the wing root, as I predicted, it was a little bit wonky because of the misalignment probably of the two wing halves here that I introduced, because you know, there were no alignment features in the wing assembly, but it was still a substantial gap along the wing root, and I ended up filling that in with stretch sprue and some filler and then rescribing the whole thing, which was definitely no fun, but that's not something that is out of the ordinary for aircraft builders, at least, you know, guys who have built a lot of World War II planes that have that smoothly rounded wing root. Okay, moving on. The rest of the small bits went on pretty easily without any real complaints. I will say that I love the fact that Airfix did a one-piece propeller. I don't know why everybody doesn't do that. Even even Tamiya doesn't always do a one-piece propeller, and frankly, it annoys me. I don't need to prove that I can assemble a propeller correctly, guys. I would rather just have it all put together and ready to stick right into its place. But enough about that. Let's talk about this landing gear thing. If you guys watched the first video, you know that I was pretty worried about the ability, about my ability to get this subassembly correctly joined to this little stub here when it came time to put the landing gear on. And that was not an unfounded fear. This is one of those things that as an engineer, and I've been in this spot, you know, when you're sitting there in front of the computer screen looking at your solid model in Pro Engineer or SolidWorks or whatever it is, it's real easy to fall in love with something like this joint, which has got this half round sort of mating stub thing, because it looks good. It logically, it should be very strong. And when you're on the computer, you can tell it, stick this mating surface to this mating surface and everything is perfect. But that's just not the way it works in the real world. There are a ton of ways that this can go wrong, and I just feel like that in spite of what Airfix is trying to do there with giving you a good historical representation of this landing gear structure, that I personally would rather have one that's easier to put together so that the end result is automatically at 93 degrees this way and 77 degrees this way. Because without it, you're left basically to hold it in place while the super glue sets up. And if you've got shaky hands or if you're clumsy like I am for other reasons, that's going to be difficult. And here's the bottom line. People are going to see the landing gear sticking out there a whole lot more than they're ever going to see this detail inside here. I don't know about you guys, but I don't allow people to just reach down, pick my model airplane up, flip it over, and look at the landing gear detail. And, you know, even in photographs, the positioning of the struts is going to be a lot more obvious. And so, again, this may be just me, but in this case, I'm going to put ease of assembling correctly as a higher priority than historical engineering accuracy. There may be other guys who see it differently, but that's my own point of view on it. Okay, I think that pretty much covers it. Is kind of a laundry list there of issues, and I think that those are important to point out. But nothing here is impossible to overcome, and there is nothing here that is that makes it impossible for you to achieve a good result. Okay, there we go. That is a pretty exhaustive look at the Airfix 1/48 scale Mark 1A Spitfire. And again, I have to apologize for it being so long and drawn out. I feel exactly like I did at this point on the first video, that surely that must be a mind-numbing and overly lengthy analysis of this thing. But again, I just don't know how else to approach it. These are all things that I would want to know as a prospective builder of this project. There's a lot of press, a lot of articles and a lot of statements online about this kit being really great. And I hate to be blunt about it, but I can't agree with that. It's not a great kit. It is a good kit. It is a very decent kit, and I'm very happy with the result. But I would be less than honest if I didn't say that it was a wrestling match at several points along the way, and that there were a number of places that I felt like it fought me in ways that it really shouldn't have if it is supposed to be a new tool kit that represents a higher level of quality. So for you guys at Airfix, I know you're probably not going to send me any Christmas cards after watching this, but please understand that I don't have anything against you guys, and I don't have anything against what you're doing. In fact, I love what you're doing. But I have an engineering background, and I know at least a little bit about injection molding and tooling. So I don't think that any of the stuff that I'm saying is unfair or unfounded. If it is, by all means, feel free to let me know. But I've done what I hope is an objective analysis of the kit and of what it takes to put it together. And if that helps the if that helps you guys at Airfix to improve it, I hope that doesn't sound arrogant, but if that helps you guys, then that's awesome. I would love that. If that helps my fellow craftsmen, though, that's the single most important thing to me. So I can't apologize for any of that. All right, I will quit talking. again, I feel like I've just been rambling, so let me just now shut my mouth and end this thing and say, as always, that if I have kept you entertained and informed for this long and you're still here, that I really appreciate. All right, guys, much love.